Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the second webinar on COVID-19 for nurses that we've been organizing through AIIMS SET facility. We were very happy with the response which we got from you and on the number of questions that you sent us and which we tried to address during the Q&A session. So continuing on the same format, we will have four talks to begin with. These talks are going to be on management of COVID patients, management of and care of these patients while they're on ventilator, and specific concerns about management of patients by COVID-19 by four different faculties from our College of Nursing at AIIMS. And this again, like last time, we'll follow up with the question and answer session. So request you to keep sending in your questions on the live chat platform, and we'll collate these questions and try to answer as many of these questions as possible towards the end of this webinar. So last few minutes will be dedicated to answering these questions. So let's start with the first talk.
Good afternoon, everybody. I welcome you all to this webinar on nursing management of patients with COVID-19. I'm Mrs. Rimpal Sharma, working as Associate Professor in College of Nursing, AIIMS, New Delhi. So first of all, about the introduction, what is actually corona infection or COVID-19? So coronaviruses causing COVID-19, they are a group of RNA viruses that cause diseases in mammals and birds. In humans, coronavirus causes respiratory tract infections that can be mild, such as some cases of the common cold, and others that can be lethal, like severe acute respiratory syndrome, also called as SARS, and Middle East respiratory syndrome, also called as or known as MERS. It spreads through respiratory tract, so it is purely a preventable disease. So here, nurses play a very important role both in the preventive and curative aspects. So the main responsibility of the nurse lies in being prepared, in early identification, and in notifying about the condition. So all the nurses and the healthcare team must receive the highest level of protection to provide care for the individuals and communities in which they serve. It is essential to develop and educate all staff on preparedness plans that provide infection control procedures and protocols used within the healthcare facility to prevent spread within the facility. If at all we are preventing or protecting ourselves from infection, then only we will be able to work and take care of our patients. So it is very important that the nurses and the healthcare professionals, they are very conscious and they protect themselves first and then become prepared for taking care of their patients. So what all we need to do as nurses? So develop inpatient, ambulatory, and home care policies and procedures that are in line with current CDC guidelines for COVID-19. Provide training to all personnel on screening and isolation procedures. Provide updated training and guidelines on the use of personal protective equipments, including the use of N95 respirators, gloves, gowns, masks, eye protection, and face shields. In subsequent webinars, you will be getting information about use of these personal protective equipments, their donning and doffing procedures. Display clear signage with instructions for access and use of personal protective equipments. Ensure consistent use of proper hand hygiene, standard precautions, and contact precautions, along with the proper use of a N95 respirator. Clearly display signage for patients that lists symptoms and instructions to wear a face mask before entering the healthcare facility, if at all the symptoms are present. Identify in advance airborne infection isolation rooms or negative pressure rooms for quarantine and screening, so that whenever the patient comes, they are taken there in well-designated rooms and further care or procedures can be performed there. Develop a telephone triage protocol for patients to access from home to minimize community-based transmission. So if at all we are having telephone triage protocol system for patients, the footfall in healthcare facilities will reduce and ultimately the risk of community-based transmission will reduce. Have available for immediate notification of patients under investigation the infection control personnel at your facility and the local and state health department so that statistics are updated regularly. Then types of patients that you will get in your healthcare facility. So mostly people infected with coronavirus will experience mild to moderate respiratory illness and recover without requiring any special treatment. They can be even cared at home. Older people and those with underlying medical problems like cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, chronic respiratory diseases, and cancer are more likely to develop serious illness. So ultimately, we can understand that all immunocompromised persons, they are at high risk of developing serious COVID illness. Then I will come on the main topic or my main focus, that is nursing management of COVID clients. So to provide the standard care to the patient, following the nursing process is the only way. We as nurses, we know that nursing process has 5 steps. First step is assessment, second diagnosis, third planning, fourth implementation, and fifth is evaluation. We need to follow all these steps in cyclical manner so as to provide complete care to our clients. So first step is assessment. Here we will see what to assess in a COVID client. It includes both history taking and physical examination. So history taking, what needs to be the focus of history? Our focus of history should be collecting information about any visit to foreign countries by self or any family members in recent past. Any contact with person infected with coronavirus. If at all the client gives this history that yes, he had traveled to any foreign country or has had any visitors coming from abroad or has had any contact with person infected with coronavirus, so this person is in suspicion of developing COVID infection. Physical examination. So look for all signs and symptoms of COVID like fatigue, fever, dry cough, sore throat, aches and pains, mainly body ache is there, chest congestion, running nose and GI upset like frequent diarrhea may be there. Assess respiratory and cardiovascular status of the patient. So for assessing the respiratory status, we need to assess the respiratory rate, breathing pattern, bilateral air entry, any breathing difficulty, and SpO2 of the patient. For assessment of cardiovascular status, assess heart rate, auscultate heart sounds, blood pressure, and capillary refill time. Also, we need to monitor axillary temperature. Assess the pain level by using visual analog scale, as person may have body ache. So we need to use any visual analog scale or even a numerical rating scale can be used for adults. So they can rate their pain on the rating scales. Assess the anxiety level of the patient. Assess for development of complications that can be pneumonia in both lungs or organ failure in several organs. Then comes, so this was all about the assessment part. Then comes nursing diagnosis, objective of our care, and the interventions that we as nurses can do in order to provide complete care to our patients. So diagnosis one is respiratory difficulty related to disease condition as evidenced by increased respiratory rate, cough, and SpO2 less than 90%. Our objective will be to reduce respiratory difficulty and maintain oxygen saturation of more than 90%. The interventions that are required will be, after assessment of vital signs, provide propped up position to the patient, as this position gives more space to the lungs to expand, thereby easing breathing. Clear the airway if needed. So clients can be taught about effective cuffing and deep breathing in order to clear the airway. Administer humidified oxygen as per prescription and continuously monitor SpO2. Let the patient drink some fluid if he can. Administer antitussive syrups as per prescription in order to relieve cough. If the patient is on mechanical ventilator, elevate the head of the patient and clear the airway by suctioning the respiratory secretions using strict aseptic techniques. Monitor all the settings of ventilator. Inform the physician on duty and make the changes in settings of ventilator if needed along with the physician. Continuously monitor SpO2. Reassess the respiratory status, that is respiratory rate, breathing pattern, bilateral air entry, and use of accessory muscles of breathing. I am not going to go into the detail of care of patient on mechanical ventilator, as this part will be taken in subsequent webinar by my colleagues. Diagnosis 2. Risk of multi-organ failure related to disease condition. The objective is to identify the risk of multi-organ failure at an early stage. The interventions that we need to do are: assess for respiratory complications. This can be done by assessing respiratory rate. Auscultate for any abnormal breath sounds like ronchi and assess SpO2 of the patient. Assess for renal complications. This will be evident by a decreased urine output. And explain to the patient about the need of lab investigations. So the patient has to undergo a renal function test in order to detect renal complications. Assess for cardiac complications by monitoring the heart rate, blood pressure, capillary refill time, productive sputum or pedal edema, and a weak thready pulse that indicates presence of sepsis and shock. Explain to the patient about the need of undergoing investigations like ECG or echo if at all they are required. Diagnosis 3 can be altered body temperature related to disease condition as evident by increased axillary temperature. Our objective is to maintain normal body temperature and provide comfort to the patient. The interventions that we can take are: assess patient's body temperature, let the patient remove extra clothing, do a tepid or cold sponging as tolerated by the patient, administer antipyretic drug as per prescription. So usually a paracetamol is administered SOS. Reassess patient's body temperature after taking all these measures. A fourth diagnosis can be acute body ache related to disease condition. Our objective is to reduce body ache and make the patient comfortable. Our interventions can be assess pain level using numerical scale or a Wong-Becker scale. We can use any visual analog scale or numerical rating scale in order to assess the severity of pain in the patient. Provide comfortable position and comfort devices. Assess the patient in changing position every 2 hourly, if at all he is completely bedridden or sedated or ventilated. Administer analgesics if required as per prescription. Provide diversion therapy if possible, like music therapy, etc. Reassess patient's pain level. A diagnosis 5 can be altered nutritional status related to reduced oral intake as evident by weight loss. Our objective will be to improve the nutritional status of the patient. Interventions will be monitor the weight and BMI of the patient, maintain strict intake and output chart, ask the patient for his or her food preferences. If at all oral intake is possible, we can offer food as per the likes of the patient. If the patient is on NG feed, initially assess the position of the nasogastric tube and then administer feed every 2 hourly or as per the prescription. Here also, we have to see that we provide completely nutritional food to the patient. It can be milk, it can be custard, it can be curd, it can be lassi, it can be coconut water mixed with protein powders or supplements like this as advised by the nutritionist or as advised by the physician. If on IV fluids, administer IV fluids as per prescription and monitor blood glucose level, and very important, monitor the hydration status of the patient. The patient should not go into hypovolemia or hypervolemia. Reassess patient's intake and output in every shift. Our sixth diagnosis can be risk of cross-infection related to disease process. Objective will be to reduce the risk of cross-infection. Interventions that we need to take are nurses caring for COVID patients should wear COVID kit available for healthcare providers. Shouldn't use his or her mobile phone. At the same time and with same PPEs, shouldn't care for non-COVID patients. Should handle the respiratory secretions of the patient carefully. Should remove all the PPEs immediately after providing care to the patient once in a shift and perform a thorough hand hygiene. Seventh diagnosis, anxiety related to disease condition as evident by frequent questioning and facial expressions. Our objective will be to reduce the anxiety level of the patient. Interventions can be make the patient comfortable and let him ventilate his or her feelings. Assess the support system of the patient and different stress coping methods used by him. Assess the knowledge level of patient related to the disease condition. Explain to the patient about the disease condition and also for need of using mask and quarantine to prevent spread of infection. Teach the patient about different stress coping strategies. Reassess the patient's anxiety level. And the last step of nursing processes, continuously monitoring or evaluating. We have to evaluate the patient's pain level and effectiveness of interventions, vital signs, signs and symptoms of dehydration, like absence of tears, a dry mucosa, in case of children, in case of infants, a sunken fontanelle, in case of adults, sunken eyes, dry skin, loss of skin turgor, loss of skin elasticity, excessive thirst, etc. Signs and symptoms of pneumonia, respiratory status, response to treatment, coping status, and complications. Continuously, as nurses, we have to evaluate all these aspects. Associated nursing procedures. As nurses, while dealing with COVID patients, we will have to perform all of these procedures. Airborne precautions, contact precautions, endotracheal tube suctioning, or repositioning or removal, intravenous drug administration, nutritional screening, oral care of intubated patients, oxygen administration via various methods, personal protective equipments, donning and doffing, respiratory hygiene, standard precautions, and specimen collection. Discharge teaching. This is also a very important responsibility of the nurse. While the patient is being discharged, following points have to be kept in mind. As a nurse, participate as part of multidisciplinary team to coordinate discharge planning efforts. Assess the patient's and family's understanding of follow-up and warning signs for which to seek medical attention. Provide the patient with written discharge summary, including the drugs to be taken after discharge. Teach the patient and his family about proper isolation, hand hygiene, cuff etiquettes, etc. Document discharge planning evaluation in patient's clinical record. Teach the patient about staying at home, disinfecting various surfaces, use of hand sanitizers, and washing hands frequently. Tell the patient about the importance of quarantine. To conclude, I would like to say that coronavirus disease 2019 or COVID-19 was reported as cluster of disease in China in December 2019. It has since spread to all continents and WHO has declared COVID-19 as a pandemic. Elderly persons with comorbidities are more affected. It spreads mainly via respiratory droplets. Pneumonia is the most common complication. Severe cases have a mortality rate of 2.3% to 5%. Presently, there is no standardized treatment or vaccine available for COVID-19. Containment and prevention is the best option.
Very good afternoon. So now we are going to discuss regarding the nursing management of patients with COVID-19, specifically with ARDS and septic shock. ARDS means acute respiratory distress syndrome and septic shock. So by this time, as we know, coronavirus disease, that is COVID-19, is a respiratory tract infection caused by a newly emergent coronavirus that was first recognized in Wuhan, China in December 2019. And the genetic sequencing of the virus suggests that it is a beta coronavirus closely linked to the SARS virus, that is severe acute respiratory syndrome virus. There are various syndromes associated with COVID-19. The patient may present with uncomplicated illness, mild pneumonia, severe pneumonia, acute respiratory distress syndrome, sepsis, and septic shock. Acute respiratory distress syndrome is a life-threatening condition in which there is sudden severe dyspnea and hypoxemia. It occurs within 1 week of non-clinical insult or injury or new or worsening respiratory symptoms. The chest imaging shows bilateral opacities that may not be fully explained by volume overload, lobar or lung collapse or nodules. The origin of pulmonary infiltrates, respiratory failure that is not fully explained by cardiac failure or fluid overload. So what happens in ARDS is that because of direct injury to the alveolus, there is a release of pro-inflammatory cytokines. These cytokines attract the neutrophils into the alveolus, where they damage the alveolar capillary membrane, that is ACM. When this alveolar capillary membrane integrity is lost, there is fluid and proteins filled in the interstitial space and the surfactant can no longer support the alveolus. Therefore, there is ventilation perfusion mismatch or there is problem with the oxygenation and the perfusion. There are various categories of acute respiratory distress syndrome: mild ARDS, moderate ARDS, and severe ARDS. Mild respiratory distress syndrome, when the ratio of PA O2 by FiO2 is more than 200 mmHg but less than or equal to 300 mmHg. Moderate when this ratio is more than 100 mmHg but less than 200 mmHg. And severe ARDS when this ratio is even less than 100 mmHg. The oxygenation impairment in children, mild ARDS, these are the invasively ventilated. In children, we use OI, that is the oxygenation index, or OSI, that is the indicator for the oxygen impairment in children. Next syndrome is sepsis. Sepsis is also a life-threatening organ dysfunction that is caused by a dysregulated host response to suspected or proven infection. The various signs of organ dysfunction include altered mental status, difficulty or fast breathing, low oxygen saturation, reduced urine output, fast heart rate, weak pulse, cold extremities or low blood pressure, skin mottling or laboratory evidence of coagulopathy, thrombocytopenia, acidosis, high lactate or hyperbilirubinemia. In children, suspected or proven infection and more than or equal to age of 2 based on systemic inflammatory response syndrome criteria, of which one must be abnormal temperature or WBC count. Septic shock, where there is persistent hypotension despite volume resuscitation, requiring vasopressors to maintain mean arterial pressure of more than 65 mmHg and serum lactate level of less than 2 millimole per liters. During septic shock, what happens? Despite giving massive therapy by volumes of fluids, there is still requirement of vasopressors or the inotropic agents that lead to vasoconstriction and improve the blood pressure. And we have to also decrease the serum lactate level. A high serum lactate level indicates hypoperfusion with signs of organ dysfunction in critically ill patients. In children, hypotension or two or three of the following: altered mental state, tachycardia or bradycardia, prolonged capillary refill or feeble pulse, tachypnea, mottled or cooled or petechial or purpuric rash, increased lactate, oliguria, hyperthermia and hypothermia. So the first intervention is immediate implementation of appropriate IPC measures, that is infection prevention and control measures. IPC is a critical and integral part of clinical management of patients and it should be initiated right at the point of entry of the patient to the hospital. Suppose we encounter the patient in emergency department. Standard precautions should always be routinely applied in all the areas of healthcare facilities, and these include hand hygiene, use of PPE to avoid direct contact with patient's blood, body fluids, secretions including the respiratory secretions, and non-intact skin. Standard precautions also include prevention of needle stick or sharps injury, safe waste management, cleaning and disinfection of equipment, and cleaning of the environment. All these have also been discussed in the webinar that had occurred on 30th of March. The various use of PPEs in ICUs are as follows: use of N95 or respirator, goggles or face shield, gown that has to be water resistant, double gloves, apron, shoe cover and hood. Now comes the nursing care of patients on mechanical ventilation. As the patient has developed the complication of ARDS and septic shock, they may be in the requirement of artificially respiratory support with the help of a mechanical ventilator. So we have to ensure that all the healthcare workers, the nurses who are performing aerosol generating procedures, for example, open suctioning of the respiratory tract, intubation procedures, bronchoscopy or CPR, we have to use the PPE including the gloves, the long sleeved gowns, eye protection and fit tested particulate respirators, those are N95. Whenever possible, use adequately ventilated single rooms when performing these procedures. That means negative pressure rooms with minimum of 12 air exchanges per hour or at least 160 liters per second per patient in facilities with natural ventilation. Avoid the presence of unnecessary individuals in the room. Care for the patient in the same type of room after mechanical ventilation commences. Very important thing, we have to avoid disconnecting the patient from the ventilator because it may lead to loss of PEEP and it may lead to atelectasis. PEEP is positive end expiratory pressure. That is the pressure that is still maintained in the alveoli of the patients even after the expiration to prevent the atelectasis. Use inline catheters for airway suctioning. Very important, that is the closed suction system has to be used while suctioning of these patients, and clamp the endotracheal tube when disconnection is required. We should never disconnect it from the ventilator, and we can clamp it if we have to transfer to a transport ventilator. Communication is also required with the patient and the family. So communicate proactively with patients and families and provide support. We have to understand the patient's values and preferences regarding life-sustaining interventions. Appropriate use of PPE for sputum specimen and sputum collection is very important. We need to use droplet and contact precautions for upper respiratory tract specimens, airborne precautions for lower respiratory tract specimens. When collecting these samples, we have to use viral swabs and not the cotton one, and we have to use the viral transport media. In the patients with suspected COVID-19, especially with pneumonia or severe illness, a single URT sample does not exclude the diagnosis. Hence, additional URT and LRT samples are recommended. Sputum induction should be avoided due to increased risk of increasing aerosol transmission. This is very important. So the procedures like bronchoscopy can also be avoided. The patients with ARDS, one of the intervention is prone ventilation for 12 hours per day. That is recommended. And this application of prone ventilation is strongly recommended for adult and pediatric patients with severe ARDS. But this requires sufficient human resources and expertise to be performed safely. So that depends from institution to institution. We also need to use a conservative fluid management strategy for ARDS patients without tissue hyperperfusion. In some hospitals, we may also go for ECMO, that is extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, for these types of patients. Another aspect is related to analgesia, sedation and delirium management, as the patient is in ICU and we have to treat the patient as a whole. So the other requirements or the other interventions also need to be done for these type of patients. We have to determine the target pain management goal every day. Assess pain with 4 hours. We can use the tools like CPOT or visual analog scale or numeric scale. Measure sedation with every 2 hours using Richmond agitation sedation scale. Titrate the infusion rate of analgesics and sedatives to achieve pain management goals. For the known painful procedures, preemptive analgesia is administered. We can also perform CAM-ICU delirium screening in every shift to ensure an early diagnosis for these type of patients. Apply centralization strategy for delirium prevention, for example, pain relief, sedation, communication, quality of sleep and early mobilization to prevent other complications of patients admitted in ICU with COVID-19. This is a look at the scale that we use in our ICU, that is critical care pain observation tool, and we assess with facial expressions or body movements, muscle relaxation, muscle tension, compliance with the ventilator or vocalization of the patients. So the total score of this tool ranges from 0 to 8. And if the score is 3 or equal to more than 3, then it is significant. This is the RAS score that we can use, that is the Richmond Agitation and Sedation Scale. Next comes prevention of ventilator-associated pneumonia. Now, once the patient is admitted in ICU with mechanical ventilation, with endotracheal tube, the patient is at high risk for developing ventilator-associated pneumonia. This type of pneumonia may occur within 48 to 72 hours of intubation. So there is a bundle to prevent or reduce the risk of ventilator associated pneumonia. Oral intubation is preferable to nasal intubation in adolescents and adults. Keep the patient in semi-recumbent position, that is head of the bed has to be elevated by 30 to 45 degrees. A closed suctioning system has to be used. Periodically drain and discard condensate in the tubing. Use a new ventilator circuit for each patient. Once the patient is ventilated, change the circuit if it is soiled or damaged, but it is not done routinely. Change the heat moisture exchanger when it malfunctions or when it is soiled, or every 5 to 7 days as per the protocol of the ICU. Other than that, the general care needs to be done adequately for the patients admitted in ICU with these type of critically clinical syndromes. So monitoring is very important. Early monitoring of vital signs should be done. Especially, we have to also assess for the changes in consciousness, respiration rate, and oxygen saturation. We can use the Glasgow Coma Scale to assess the changes in consciousness. Also observe the symptoms like cough, sputum, chest tightness, dyspnea, cyanosis, as well as we have to also analyze the ABG gas analysis so as to assess for any acidosis or alkalosis. Timely recognition of any deterioration to adjust strategies of oxygen therapy or to take urgent response measures. We have to also pay attention to ventilator-associated lung injury when under high positive end expiratory pressure and high pressure support is provided to the patient. Also closely monitor the changes in the airway pressure, the tidal volume and the respiratory rate. Implement strategies to prevent catheter-related bloodstream infections and catheter-related urinary tract infections. So for example, for catheter-related bloodstream infections, hand washing has to be performed, aseptic techniques have to be used, we can use a transparent dressing, we can daily assess the site of the catheter insertion, and for preventing the complications related to UTI infection, we have to see the need for the catheter, we have to keep the level of the bladder, the urobag level at the level lower than the bladder. Prevent pressure-induced skin injuries, including device-related pressure injuries, incontinence-associated dermatitis, and medical adhesive-related skin injuries. We have to also identify patients at high risk and implement preventive strategies for those types of patients. We have to assess all the patients upon admission and whether clinical conditions change with the venous thromboembolism risk assessment model to identify those who are at high risk and implement the preventive strategies. We have to monitor the coagulation function, D-dimer levels, and VTE-related clinical manifestations. Provide enteral nutrition at early stages for those who are able to eat by mouth. During each shift, adjust the enteral nutrition rate and quantity according to the tolerance of enteral nutrition. Specific nursing interventions for septic shock. So we have to recognize septic shock in adults when the infection is suspected or confirmed and there is a need for vasopressors to maintain the mean arterial pressure of more than or equal to 65 mmHg, and we have to maintain lactate at a level of less than 2 millimole per liter in the absence of hypovolemia. In resuscitation from septic shock in adults, give at least 30 ml per kg of isotonic crystalloids in adults in the first 3 hours. In resuscitation from septic shock in children, in well-resourced settings, give 20 ml per kg as a rapid bolus and up to 40 to 60 ml per kg in the first 1 hour. Do not use hypotonic crystalloids, starches or gelatins for resuscitation. Fluid resuscitation sometimes may lead to volume overload, including respiratory failure. So if there is no response to fluid overloading and signs of volume overload appear, for example, there is jugular venous distension, crackles on lung auscultation, pulmonary edema on imaging, or hepatomegaly in children, then reduce or discontinue fluid administration. Administer vasopressors when shock persists during or after fluid resuscitation. The initial blood pressure target is to maintain the mean arterial pressure of more than or equal to 65 mmHg in adults and age-appropriate targets in children. If central venous catheters are not available, vasopressors can also be given through a peripheral IV, but use of a large vein and closely monitoring the signs of extravasation and local tissue necrosis. If extravasation occurs, we have to immediately stop the infusion. Vasopressors can also be administered through intraosseous needles. So, as the patient is there in the ICU, the very important thing is that we have to prevent the complications, the various complications that can occur. We have to try to reduce the number of days of invasive mechanical ventilation. So for this, what can be done? We can use weaning protocols that include daily assessment for readiness to breathe spontaneously. We have to minimize continuous or intermittent sedation, targeting specific titration endpoints, or with daily interruption of continuous sedative infusions. Again, have to reduce the incidence of ventilator-associated pneumonia. So for this, we have discussed oral intubation is preferable. We have to keep the patient in a semi-recumbent position. Closed suctioning system is very much important. Use of a new ventilator circuit for each patient once the patient is ventilated. Change the circuit if it is soiled or damaged, but not routinely. Change heat moisture exchanger when it malfunctions, when soiled, or every 5 to 7 days. Next, there can be complication of venous thromboembolism. So we need to reduce the incidence of venous thromboembolism. We have to use pharmacological prophylaxis, that is low molecular weight heparin preferred if available, or heparin 5000 units subcutaneously twice daily in adolescents and adults without contraindications. For those with contraindications, we have to use mechanical prophylaxis like intermittent pneumatic compression devices that we usually do for the patients. Another important thing is that we have to also reduce the incidence of catheter-related bloodstream infection. So we have to use a checklist with completion verified by a real-time observer as a reminder of each step needed for sterile insertion and as a daily reminder to remove catheter if it is no longer needed. Reduce the incidence of stress ulcers and GI bleeding. Give early enteral nutrition, that is within 24 to 48 hours of admission. We can administer histamine 2 receptor blockers or PPIs in patients with risk for GI bleeding. Risk factors for GI bleeding include mechanical ventilation for more than 48 hours, coagulopathy, renal replacement therapy, liver disease, multiple comorbidities, and higher organ failure scores. Reduce the incidence of ICU-related weakness, so we can actively mobilize the patient early in the course of illness when safe to do so. And we have to also reduce the incidence of pressure ulcers in those patients, so we can turn the patient every 2 hours. So in a nutshell, we have to use proper PPE while giving care to the patient in ICU, and the patient may be on mechanical ventilator. We should not disconnect the ET tube from the ventilator. We have to use closed suctioning system so as to avoid the contact with the aerosols, and we have to also decrease the procedures where there is emission of the aerosols from the patient. So these are my references. You can send your questions or queries in the comments. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to the webinar session on caring precaution for patients in mechanical ventilator. We all know that currently there is a global pandemic on COVID-19. Treatment of severe acute respiratory distress syndrome from COVID-19 is an ongoing challenge in the treatment of patients with COVID-19. The most common and severe complication in patients with COVID-19 is acute hypoxemic respiratory failure, or ARDS, that is acute respiratory distress syndrome, requiring oxygen and ventilation therapies. Recently published data reveals approximately 3.2% of patients with COVID-19 required intubation and invasive ventilation at some point in the disease course. This data comes from China, which is recently published in a reputed journal. Caring for a patient with COVID-19 with mechanical ventilation presents some unique challenges to nurses, because you all know that nurses spends maximum time in direct contact with the patient than any other healthcare workers. This poses a high risk, and that's why this is a unique challenge to nurses to take care of these patients. Efficient nursing care of patients with COVID-19 who are put on mechanical ventilator plays a major role in outcome of the treatment. First of all, we talk about PPE required to be donned prior to the entry into the patient room. This is as per the recommendation by Hospital Infection Control Committee, AIIMS, New Delhi. First of all, N95 respirator, which is fit tested. Without fit testing, the N95 respirator will be less effective or will not be protecting 100%. How you fit test the N95 respirator? After putting on the N95 respirator, force exhale and check whether there is a positive pressure inside the mask, and force inhale, and you have to see the negative pressure inside the mask, which is evidenced by inward pushing of the mask. Then goggles or face shield, you can see in this picture, goggle or face shield, either one of these supposed to be used. Then water resistant gown and or full sleeve gown also nowadays used. If that is used, this is not required. Then gloves, there are two pairs of gloves required, and apron, which is optional, because when you put on water resistant gown, this may or may not be necessary, but however that is optional to wear apron. Then shoe cover, then comes hood. Hood covers head as well as the neck. However, when you use a full suit, this hood may not be necessary, because the full suit comes along with the hood. So this is how that full suit looks like. Now the checklist for donning of PPE. So in previous session there was detailed discussion about the PPE, how to wear, how to do donning and doffing, all those stuff. So I'm not going into the details, but let us briefly see what is the sequence in which the donning of PPE is supposed to be done. First of all, wash hands with soap and water or perform a hand hygiene procedure as per the recommendation. Then wear shoe cover. Then wear first pair of gloves. Then wear gown. Wear the mask or a respirator, N95 respirator. Check for any leaks, that is, it is supposed to be fit tested. Then wear goggles or face shield. Then wear hood. And wear second pair of gloves. Then gown fitness check. Ask your buddy to help in checking the fitness of the PPE. So now, what are the precautions while donning and doffing PPE supposed to be taken care of? First of all, get into scrubs or comfortable cloths. Remove jewelry. Ensure you have water and food, and visited washrooms before you enter into ICU or isolation room, because the nurses are expected to stay inside ICU or isolation room for at least 6 hours. So visiting toilet or washroom or visiting for another purpose for food or water in between will consume again all the PPEs, and it will consume the time also, because you've seen what are the steps required for donning and doffing. It will take longer time. So hands should be bare below elbow. Take only essential items inside, like one or two pens and a pair of scissors and any other required pocket article as per unit policy. The articles may be kept in a separate packet. The observer needs to be in PPE when observing doffing. The observer who is observing the doffing also has to be in complete set of PPE. Check all PPE before starting donning. Now all the PPE should be in correct size. This is very, very important, because if you wear an incorrect size of PPE, that may results in breakage of PPE somewhere. So there are high risk for contamination. So please check for the correct size PPE. Two chairs should be placed in doffing area. One is labeled as dirty and the other one is labeled as clean. Never touch your face while wearing PPE. Avoid touching eyes, nose or mouth with contaminated gloved or ungloved hands. And change gloves when soiled and after any procedure on a patient. And hand hygiene should be done anytime the WHO 5 moments apply and before PPE and after removing PPE. In addition to the 5 moments which WHO recommends, you also have to do hand washing before PPE and after removing PPE. Critical care management of mechanically ventilated patients with COVID-19. A role of non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, otherwise known as NIPPV, had limited role, because patients are very much tachypneic or hypoxic, so that NIPPV may not be very effective. And secondly, and most importantly, frequent interruption by the patient may cause more aerosolization of virus. In terms of for COVID-19, this is very, very important, because it is a droplet infection, so aerosolization of virus will cause very high risk of transmission of infection. So that's why this is not recommended. But if use of NIPPV cannot be avoided, for example,
If the inflow of the patient is more than the capacity, we reach to a situation where more patient inflow, we don't have facility due to less ICU beds or non-availability of mechanical ventilator. In that situation, use NIPPV with helmet-mask interface as shown in these pictures down, with helmet-mask interface. This is precaution for patients receiving high flow nasal cannula, that is HFNC oxygen therapy. Provide, first of all, it's very important to provide detailed information of the HFNC oxygen therapy to get the patient's cooperation before implementation. As I already discussed in the previous slide also, frequent interruption by the patient may lead to aerosol generation that will put everyone into very high risk of transmission. So choose a proper nasal catheter based on the diameter of the patient's nasal cavity. Adjust the head strap tightness and use decompression plaster to prevent device related pressure injuries on the facial skin. Patient's drool, snort and sputum should be wiped with a tissue paper and be disposed in a sealed container with the chlorine containing disinfectant. That disinfectant solution with the concentration of 2500 mg/L. Alternatively, secretions can be removed by oral mucus extractor or suctioning tube and be disposed in a sputum collector with the chlorine containing disinfectant. And however, the oral mucus extractor use is questionable or to be avoided because high risk of contamination. The caution while intubation or resuscitation of the patient. Try to do with the minimal possible number of people because this is a high aerosol generation risk with the full PPE precautions. First thing is to do with the minimal possible number of people. The second thing is all the people who are involved in this procedure should be in full PPE precautions and full set of PPE should be worn. Next is reduce movement of staff in the ward. Standard intubation and resuscitation protocols to be followed with utmost importance of prevention of infection. Intubate early under controlled conditions if possible, a low threshold for watchful wait. Need a separate cubicle or patient room for intubated patients. Continuous hemodynamic and oxygenation monitoring is required. Use a conservative fluid management strategy for ARDS patients who are not in shock to shorten the duration of mechanical ventilation. This is particularly very important to shorten the duration of mechanical ventilation. Use a conservative fluid management strategy because if the patient is off from mechanical ventilation, we are conserving the resource for other person because when the situation get worse or we get more patient inflow, this is very, very important. And continuous purify and disinfect the room with the plasma air purification technology for 30 minutes after completion of intubation. Coming to the prevention of ventilator associated pneumonia. The ventilator associated pneumonia is one of the common complications or hospital acquired infection by the patient who are mechanically ventilated in ICUs. The VAP bundle is used to prevent this ventilator associated pneumonia, which includes, first of all, hand washing or hand hygiene. Rise head end of bed by 30 to 45 degree if no contradiction is presented. Oral care to be given every 4 to 6 hours. Maintain endotracheal tube cuff pressure at 30 to 35 cm of water every 4 hours. Enter nutrition support and monitor gastric residual volume every 4 hours. Evaluating daily for ventilator removal. Using washable tracheal tubes for continuous subglottic suctioning combined with the 10 ml syringe suctioning every 1 to 2 hours and adjust this suctioning frequency according to the actual amount of secretion. So as per the secretion, amount of secretion which is aspirated, or as per the amount of secretion which was suctioned, adjust the frequency of suctioning. It's not just fixed at every 1 to 2 hours. The syringe containing the subglottic secretions is immediately used to aspirate an appropriate amount of chlorine containing disinfectant, that is 2500 milligram per liter, then be recapped and disposed of in a shop container. Before disposing this syringe into the shop container, appropriate amount of chlorine containing disinfectant supposed to be aspirated into the syringe. So that is disinfecting the secretion at the point of generation itself, or even before disposing it. Coming to the sputum suction, what are the precautions to be taken while sputum suction is done? Use a closed sputum suction system, including closed suction catheter and closed disposable collection bag, to reduce the formation of aerosol on and droplets. Airborne precautions are recommended only for aerosol generating procedure. Those procedure, for example, open suctioning of respiratory tract, intubation, bronchoscopy and cardiopulmonary resuscitation are likely to be considered as aerosol generating procedures. Collection of sputum specimen. Use a closed suction catheter and a matching collection bag to reduce exposure to droplets. Coming to the disposal of condensation from ventilators. So there will be condensation in the tubings, all those things. So how to dispose those condensation from ventilators? Use a disposable ventilator tubing with a dual loop heating wire and automatic humidifier to reduce the formation of condensation. So to reduce the formation of condensation, so dual loop heating wire and the disposable ventilator tubings are recommended, and the automatic humidifier also helps reducing the formation of condensation. Two nurses should cooperate to dump the condensation promptly into a capped container with chlorine containing disinfectant. The container can then be directly put in a washing machine, which can be heated up to 90 degrees Celsius for automatic cleaning and disinfection, provided you have this facility in your setting. Precaution during certain procedure and equipment while taking care of patient who is on mechanical ventilator. Equipment should be single use whenever possible and dedicated to the patient and disinfected between uses. Limit the number of healthcare workers attending a patient, and everyone must wear full set of PPE. This is very, very important. Limit the number. Reduce the number as much as possible. All persons entering the patient's room should be recorded. This is also very important. It is particularly for the purpose of tracing. So to trace the person who come in contact with the infected persons. Here you have to note one thing, that we are carrying the people who are known case of COVID-19, confirmed cases of COVID-19. So complete bedside check should be done by a nurse to ensure suction equipment, back wall mask and artificial airway are functional and present at bedside. Verify ventilator settings with the prescribed order. Whatever the order prescribed, according to that you have to verify whether the ventilator settings are all right. Suction for the shortest time possible. Usually it is 10 seconds, but as much as possible reduce the time. That is, do suction with the shortest time possible and use the lowest pressure required to remove secretions. Apply airborne precautions when performing suction, as it is an aerosol generating process. Use inline, or otherwise called closed suctioning catheters, for airway suctioning, and clamp endotracheal tube when disconnection is required. For example, when you need to transfer to a transport ventilator, then whenever you supposed to remove, then you do clamping of endotracheal tube. All respiratory equipment must be protected with a high efficiency filter. This filter must be disposed of after use. Usually there are two types of filters. One is pleated mechanical filter and electrostatic filters. But the pleated mechanical filters are preferred because electrostatic filters can lose effectiveness with humidity. What are the precautions which are related to environment in ICU or isolation room where the patient is mechanically ventilated? Routine cleaning of the environment is crucial. Avoid contaminating surfaces not involved with direct patient care, for example, doorknobs, light switches, mobile phones, which may come in contact with any person so that it increases the chance of transmission. So try not to contaminate these surfaces, which is not in direct contact with the patient. If single rooms are not available, make sure that patients are separated by at least 1 meter apart. Provide adequate ventilation. Natural ventilation with airflow of at least 160 liter per patient, or in negative pressure rooms with at least 12 air exchanges per hour and controlled direction of airflow. Remove all PPE before exiting the patient room except a respirator, N95 mask. Remove the respirator after leaving the patient room and closing the door. What are the precautions when you handle linen in the patient room or in ICU? Linen should be stored in a designated area, either in closet or sluice room or closed containers. Handle soiled linen with minimum agitation to avoid contamination. Whenever you handle the linen, do not, you know, with a maximum, with whenever possible, handle the linen with minimal agitation, because that will lessen the chance of contamination, minimize the chance of contamination. Place soiled linen into clearly labeled bags or containers at point of care. And if the linen is grossly soiled, then remove gross soil, for example, feces, with a gloved hand and using a flat, firm object, and discard solid material into flush toilet and dispose towel into waste. Finally, when you come out, when you're doing a doffing, you have to follow the following steps very strictly, because the doffing, the steps on sequence of doffing is more important than donning itself, because there are very high chance if you are not doing properly with the sequence of doffing, it is highly likely that you may get contaminated. So be careful on this part. First of all, check for any leak or soiling in PPE before doffing, and if there is a leak or soiling found, disinfect the site if contaminated. If you find any soiling or leak, please disinfect. And there should be another person with complete PPE should be observing this doffing process, which I have already discussed earlier. And disinfect the hands, similar to hand hygiene. After that, then remove shoe covers only by touching the outer surface by sitting on a dirty chair, and perform hand hygiene again. Remove outer gloves, perform hand hygiene again, then remove hood, perform hand hygiene again, remove gown and again perform hand hygiene, remove goggles or face shield, perform hand hygiene again, remove second pair of gloves, perform hand hygiene again, wear new pair of gloves, then remove mask. When removing mask, do not touch the front of the mask. It is it is assumed to be contaminated or exposed, and handle with slings or bands from behind. Perform hand hygiene again. Clean all pocket articles, that is pens and scissors, with alcohol swab and disinfectant, and perform again hand hygiene. Clean shoes with alcohol swabs by sitting on clean chair, and again remove last pair of gloves and perform hand hygiene again. And we come to the end of the presentation. So we have discussed how to what are the precautions the nurse to take care while caring for a patient with COVID on mechanical ventilator. The focus is, first of all, it is for the safety of the patient, and second is for the safety of the healthcare workers, because the COVID-19 is a droplet infection, and you have to take care of aerosol precautions while taking care of patient who is on mechanical ventilator, because you may come in, you may get exposed to aerosol generating procedure. So you need to take care well. And thank you very much for listening. These are the references. Thank you.
Good afternoon. So I'll be discussing the specific concerns related to COVID unit. So what is a COVID unit? COVID units are basically isolation wards of hospitals which have been made ready to take care of COVID patients in order to tackle the COVID-19 global pandemic. COVID-19 units also include the areas in the hospital where a suspected patient may visit, for example, the waiting areas, quarantine units, critical care areas, etc. Health units or hospitals are utilized to make isolation facilities with requisite number of equipment for the medical staff to handle such cases effectively. These units are adequately ventilated, preferably negative pressure rooms with a minimum of 12 air changes per hour or at least 160 liters per second per patient in facilities with natural ventilation. So this is a negative air pressure room where the passive airflow is flowing from one side and the air is forced out from the other side. So a negative pressure is created in the rooms. So COVID patients who are diagnosed with COVID, they are preferably to be cared for in these type of rooms. If these are not available, then these patients may be cared for preferably in the upper floors of the hospital so that the air is going into the upper layer of the atmosphere and not in contact with the population. Who all need isolation? Any person diagnosed with the SARS-CoV virus 2 infection by means of laboratory testing at a government recommended testing laboratory. Anyone who has symptoms of fever and respiratory illness and has a history of close contact of a person who has either been diagnosed as COVID or has a history of travel to a COVID affected region within the last 14 days. Any healthcare worker with symptoms of fever and respiratory illness who has been involved directly in treating the COVID-19 patients or has close contact with persons involved in treating COVID-19 patients during the last 14 days. Where to isolate? So these patients who are asymptomatic with exposure to COVID positive patients can be quarantined at their homes, but they need to be under strict surveillance by the government authorities. Suspected patients who are having symptoms to be isolated in well ventilated, preferably separate rooms. Symptomatic COVID positive patients should be hospitalized in the isolation rooms or the COVID units and also should be monitored adequately by the medical team. Respiratory samples, if needed, of these patients should be collected from the COVID units or a separate space where there is HEPA filters or a negative pressure ventilation room. Now we'll come to know about the preparation of a COVID unit. So for preparation of a COVID unit, we have to ensure that appropriate hand washing facilities and hand hygiene supplies are available in the room. And we have to stock the sink area where the hand washing supplies are there with suitable supplies and with alcohol-based hand rub near the point of care and the room door. We have to ensure adequate room ventilation is there in the unit, and we have to post signs on the door indicating that the space is a COVID unit or an isolation area. All visitors should consult the healthcare worker in charge before being allowed into the unit, if at all they are allowed. And we should keep a roster of all staff working in the COVID units for possible outbreak investigation and contact tracing. We have to remove all essential furniture and ensure that the remaining furniture is easy to clean. So only minimum furniture is to be kept in the COVID unit because to minimize the spread of infection from the fomites. So keep the patient's personal belongings also to a minimum. We have to stock the personal protective equipment and linen outside the unit or area, for example, the change room or the designated areas for the donning and doffing of the PPE, and set up a trolley outside the door to hold the PPE. And a checklist is useful to ensure that all equipment is available. We have to also place appropriate waste bags in a bin. If possible, use a touch-free bin. Ensure that used bins remain inside the COVID unit or area, that is the waiting area or the quarantine wards. If the COVID patients are visiting the waiting area, the quarantine areas, etc., the bins should remain inside. It should not be outside so that all the disposal is done inside the rooms. Place containers for disposal of sharps inside the unit or the area. Dedicate non-critical patient care equipment, that is the stethoscope, thermometer, blood pressure cuffs, pygmomanometer, etc. to the patient if possible. Thoroughly clean and disinfect patient care equipment every time before using in the next patient. If dedicated equipment is not available, we have to ensure that between the patients, the equipments are thoroughly disinfected. Adequate equipment required for cleaning or disinfection inside the unit should be kept and room should be cleaned on a daily basis. Set up a telephone or other method of communication in the unit or area to enable patients, family members or visitors to communicate with healthcare workers. This may reduce the number of times the workers need to don PPE to enter the room or the area. Now, what are the instructions to be given for patients in the COVID units? So we have to give the suspected patient a medical mask and teach him to wear it properly, covering the nose and the mouth, and it should be fit snugly around the face. And the patient should be instructed to wear the face mask as much as time possible in a day. Instruct patient to cover nose and mouth during coughing or sneezing. Instruct the patient to perform hand hygiene after contact with respiratory secretions. Restrict movement of patients for chest x-rays, CT scans, labs, as this may lead to dissemination of infection to other places. So as far as possible, mobile x-rays and CT scans to be made available. Patient needs to be kept in isolation till his respiratory samples turn out to be negative. So for the healthcare workers, wearing and removing personal protective equipment in COVID units. So before entering the COVID unit or area, we have to collect all the necessary items and we have to ensure to perform hand hygiene with an alcohol-based rub or soap and water. Use the PPE in the order that ensures adequate placement of PPE items and prevents self-contamination and self-inoculation while using and taking off PPE. So this is a graphic representation of what is the sequence. This has been discussed in the yesterday's webinar also. So we have to arrange all the PPE first, then put on a gown. Third step is to put on the respirator or the N95 mask, then put on the eye protection. Last, put on the gloves over the cuff. And if you are caring for the COVID patients, we have preferably double gloves is required. Now leaving the COVID unit, what all to be taken care is, remove the PPE in the anteroom. There is a designated room for doffing the PPE also. And if there is no anteroom, make sure that the PPE will not contaminate either the environment outside the unit or area or other people. Remove PPE in a manner that prevents self-contamination or self-inoculation with the contaminated PPE or hands. So some of the principles are, remove the most contaminated PPE first. Perform hand hygiene immediately after removing gloves. Remove the mask or particulate respirator last. Discard disposable items in a closed bin. Put the reusable items in a dry, closed container. An example of the order to which to take off PPE is, first is the gown, gloves. If the gown is disposable, gloves can be peeled off together with gown upon removal. Hand hygiene, gown removal, eye protection, mask or respirator, and hand hygiene. So first, gloves is removed. If it can be peeled off together with the gown, it can be done. Otherwise, the gloves is removed first, then we perform hand hygiene, then the inner gloves is again removed, then the gown, the eye protection, mask, respirator, and the perform hand hygiene again. Perform hand hygiene with an alcohol-based hand rub or soap and water whenever ungloved hands touch the contaminated PPE items. So this is the graphic representation of leaving the COVID unit or doffing. So first is, we have to remove the gloves, then we have to do the hand washing. If the gown can be removed with the gloves, it is done. Otherwise, first the gloves, then hand washing, then the cap is removed, remove goggles, put goggles in the separate container for reprocessing, remove respirator from behind and perform hand hygiene. We also have to apply contact precautions. The contact precautions prevent direct or indirect transmission from contact with contaminated surfaces or equipment, that is contact with contaminated oxygen tubings interfaces. Use PPE and practice frequent hand hygiene. If possible, use disposable or dedicated equipment for each patient. If equipment needs to be shared, ensure adequate cleaning and disinfecting between each patient use. Ensure that healthcare workers refrain from touching their eyes, nose, and mouth with potentially contaminated gloved or ungloved hands. Avoid contaminating environmental surfaces that are not directly related to patient care, example, door handles and light switches. Avoid medically unnecessary movement of patients or transport. Airborne precautions when performing aerosol generating procedures. Now, certain aerosol generating procedures are done in the COVID units, may be done, for example, the open suctioning, intubation, bronchoscopy. So during that time, we have to ensure the usage of appropriate PPE, that is gloves, long sleeved gowns, eye protection, respirators, and aprons can also be used if gowns are not fluid resistant. So this is a guidance chart for the use of PPE in different COVID unit settings. So in the ICU, if you're caring for the COVID patients in the ICU, the healthcare workers, that is in doctors, nurses, technicians, should wear the N95 respirators, goggles, face shield, gown should be water resistant, double gloves, apron, shoe cover and hood when they are performing any aerosol generating procedures as discussed earlier. The cleaner, the sweeper and the hospital attendant caring or doing their work in the ICU, caring for disinfection of the room and the ICUs, should wear N95 respirators, goggles, gown, gloves, apron, shoe cover and hood. In the ward settings, the healthcare workers, that is the doctors, nurses and the technicians, if they are involved in the non-aerosol generating procedures, they are to wear the N95 respirators, goggles, gown, gloves, double gloves, shoe cover and hood. The cleaner, the sweeper and the hospital attendant involved in disinfection and patient shifting should use N95 mask, heavy duty gloves, goggles, gown, boots, hood. This is again the graphical representation of showing the rational use of personal protective equipment. So in the triaging area, there is a moderate risk of exposure. So we should use the N95 mask or the respirator and the gloves. At the help desk counter or registration counters, again, there's a risk of exposure which is moderate. We have to wear the N95 mask and the gloves. In the OPD area, doctor's chambers, the risk is again moderate if they are not seeing the COVID patients. So N95 mask and gloves are required. In the waiting area, again, there's a moderate risk. N95 mask and the gloves are required. In the isolation areas, wards, there is a moderate risk. So N95 mask, gloves are required. If in the wards aerosol generating procedures are done, then all the PPE is required. In the ICU and the critical areas, the risk is very high. So we have to wear the cap, the N95 mask, the gloves, goggles, overall or the gown and the shoe covers. Emergency department, patient attending emergency cases, the risk is medium and the worker should wear N95 respirators, the gloves and the gloves. In the emergency department, attending emergency cases with severely ill patients with SARS or COVID, the healthcare worker should wear the cap, the N95 mask, the gloves, goggles, overall or the gown and the shoe covers. In the laboratory staff, again, the risk is very high. So they should also be fully protected with the cap, N95 mask, double gloves, goggles, apron and the shoe covers. Healthcare workers at quarantine facilities, the risk is low. So as to say, they are only for health monitoring and temperature recording. If the staff is there only for health monitoring and temperature recording, the risk is low. So they can do with the triple layer mask and the gloves. At quarantine facilities, if the healthcare personnel is involved with the clinical examination of symptomatic patients, the risk is again moderate and the healthcare personnel can wear the respirators and the gloves. The administrative staff, the risk is low. and if needed, they can wear the triple layer mask. Cleaning of COVID units, we have to again wear personal protective equipment while carrying out cleaning and disinfection works. Cleaning agents and disinfectants used are 1% sodium hypochlorite is used. The solution should be prepared fresh and we have to leave the solution for a contact time of at least 10 minutes. And alcohol, 70% alcohol can be used to wipe down surfaces where the use of bleach is not suitable. For example, metal equipments are not to be advised to clean with sodium hypochlorite. They can be mopped with alcohol-based drops. So what is the frequency of cleaning these COVID units? So the surfaces which are categorized as high touch surfaces, where the touching of surfaces is in a frequent manner, for example, the doorknobs, telephone, call bells, bed rails, stair rails, light switches, wall areas around the toilet, the disinfection should be done every 1 to 2 hourly where suspected or confirmed patients are kept. Where there is no suspected or confirmed patients, 2 to 3 hourly disinfection of these high touch surfaces should be done. And in the non-clinical areas, for example, in the waiting areas and all, the high touch surfaces should be disinfected 3 to 4 hourly. In the low touch surfaces are those surfaces which are not frequently touched. For example, the walls of the rooms, of the waiting areas, mirrors, mopping should be done. So in the clinical areas where the suspected or confirmed patients are kept, the mopping or disinfection should be done every 2 to 2 or 3 hourly. Where no suspected patients are kept, there the disinfection should be done every 3 to 4 hourly. And in the non-clinical areas, it should be done once per shift. Now, after cleaning, certain precautions needed to be taken. First is hand washing. Hand washing with soap and water immediately after removing the PPE and when cleaning and disinfection work is completed. Discard all PPE used ones in a double bag biohazard bag, which should then be securely sealed and labeled. The staff should be aware of the symptoms and should report to their occupational health services if they develop symptoms. So to conclude, caring for suspected diagnosed patients in COVID units is one of the major steps in controlling the global pandemic. Healthcare workers, being the front line in handling the pandemic, should employ the best practices in safeguarding themselves and the community at large.